If you haven't heard about Anchor, it's the easiest way to make a podcast. Let me explain. It's free. There's creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast right from your phone or computer. Anchor will distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard in Spotify, Apple Podcasts, and many more. You can make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership. It's everything you need to make a podcast in one place.
All right, everybody, and welcome to the Pro Zone. This is Rick joining me, as always, the troops, the cast of characters, the DVD freak, and Dan the Beast. What's going on, gentlemen?
Hey, how are you?
This describes the night very well.
Yeah, I have to tell you that this is possibly the most disappointing pay-per-view in all of All Elite Wrestling history in their short tenure. What have they been, around a year now? Probably
a little over, yeah. If you count all in, this would be 2 years.
Yeah. So I gotta tell you that I was sorely disappointed. Now, first off, I missed about the first 40 minutes of the show because I was driving home, brought my kids back to their house, and apparently I didn't miss much judging by the lineup. So I didn't watch the pre-show either, but freak. Why don't you fill us in on a little bit of that? I guess there were a couple dark matches.
Yeah, I didn't watch the pre-show. I wasn't home in time.
Yeah.
But oh, go ahead.
Yeah, no, I guess the year was first pre-show match, Joey Janela defeated Serpentico with Luther. I think Luther should go away forever because he's annoying. I don't know. I don't know how he, 20-some-odd years later, ended up with a job here in AEW in the United States. Just my opinion. But Private Party defeated the Dork Order. Alex Reynolds and Chuck Silver. That sounds like a barn burner, just as good as Tommy Rich and Mad Dog Buzz Sawyer. You know, the last battle of Atlanta, that kind of... Anyways, I did not see the first, let's see, three matches. Walked in during the fourth. So, Big Swole defeated Britt Baker. What's your opinion? Did you see this?
Okay. So, all right. Here's the thing. You have Big Swole show up to a fucking dentist's office. And there's a receptionist. She's like, oh, do you have an appointment? And then fucking Britt Baker shows up. And they just start brawling in a fucking dentist's office. They start hitting each other with framed certificates. There's a power drill. And the finish is literally Britt Baker taking anesthesia. Like, through a fucking mask. And she injected herself in the thigh with, like, Novocaine. This was fucking ridiculous. Like, this is not how you start a show off, okay? This show would have been good starting off with, you know, the Young Bucks and the Young Bucks match. That wasn't a great match. Yeah, that wasn't a great match, but that easily could have been the opener. And, like, what the fuck happened? How did we get here? Like, this is not... I don't know. Maybe I missed something. This was called, what, the Tooth and Nail match. Yeah, Tooth and Nail match. Yep. This doesn't have an official time on Wikipedia, so there was a referee involved, though. He showed up at the dentist's office. This was just, I guess, their attempt at a cinematic match, I guess.
Why are they doing a cinematic, starting a show off with a cinematic match? That does not make any sense. Those seem, in my opinion, seem to just be things that... go in the middle of the card or the end of the card. You get what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Depending on their importance to the storyline. and I don't really, I mean, to the show, this one doesn't really seem like it's that important to the show. No, no offense to either of the ladies involved. I think they're both very talented, but
yeah,
you know,
yeah, they, you know, I think,
you know, you get what I'm saying.
Yeah, they're both great, and this is just demoralizing. Like, what the hell? And it wasn't even, it didn't even look like a dentist's office. It was just white rooms with a dentist chair. And then out of nowhere, she'll just pull a needle out or a fucking oxygen mask. And she's like, and Britt Baker's like, oh no, I injected myself with Novocaine. What am I gonna do? So then her leg went numb. And I'm just like, fuck me. Like, this is literally one of the dumbest things I've ever fucking seen. Like,
so right off the bat, they're overdoing it with the comedy.
Yeah.
Right off the bat.
Yeah.
Sounds it.
Oh my god.
It just sounds like a bunch of bullshit, from what I understand. From what I've heard. I mean, that the online reviews, I was following Twitter pretty pretty closely throughout the entire event. One person, out of anybody I saw, said that it was a good show. Legitimately. Everybody else was like, this is ridiculous.
And who's that fucking asshole?
He's actually a good buddy of mine. That doesn't mean he's not a fucking asshole.
Do we need to burn his house down or something?
Like... No, well, you live closer to him than I do. So the Young Bucks defeated Jurassic Express. Another one I did not see. We're in 14 minutes, 50 seconds. This sounds like it has all the potential in the world to be a great match, to be honest.
Hold on.
Okay.
But before we get into that, like, you know, I just want to give my thoughts about this. Now, first of all, I didn't see the pay-per-view at all. Secondly, what the fuck does a nail and a tooth match have to do with fucking anything of a concept? Three, how the fuck did they get away, you know, how did they get away with having a syringe onto a show? Like, who the fuck's ever used a syringe in wrestling? That's the one thing. Like, I've seen Kurt Angle use an elephant dart on the Big Show, but this is like far beyond.
Right.
Way too fucking far. And from what I've seen, Big Swole, I mean, don't get me wrong, I really don't know who Big Swole is, but she definitely deserves so much more mic time from what it looks like, because she could definitely trash talk. From what it looks like. And the other thing, I swear, if the wrong person on a dental board sees this match and thinks it's real, I guarantee you Dr. Britt Baker would probably lose her fucking license.
Well, they had many, I think there was like 3 or 4 times they just started hitting each other with a fucking certificate that was hanging on the wall. So, and you even had at one point someone get punched through a certificate, and I'm like, okay, the person punching it would hurt more than the person taking the punch. It's broken fucking glass.
Well, at least it has somewhat of, you know, at least it has some authenticity now, you know, if it gets punched. So.
Ha. Oh, God. But yeah, this tag match, I don't like the Young Bucks. I think we all know that by now. But I will admit they can work when they're not fucking around jumping and doing flips and shit. But
they want to be the Rockers, basically. Yeah.
Yeah, they're a mix between the Rockers and they're the mix between a wannabe rocker and a wannabe Hardy Boy. But
right.
You know, I actually like Jurassic Express. I love Luchasaurus.
I do too.
And this match had all the potential. It went 14 minutes and 50 seconds, which I think is a good run time. I said, I think this should have been the opener. It was well-paced match. It was a fun match. It really didn't do much for the card. It was a tag team match, you know?
Right.
It didn't elevate the card, but it didn't bring it down. It felt like a Wednesday Night Dynamite tag team match. And that's not a bad thing. It's just, it didn't feel like a pay-per-view caliber tag match that these two teams could have together.
Right. Dan, do you have an opinion?
Well, I like how the announcers took their time pointing out all the fucking heelish things that the Young Bucks did. You know, it's pretty good to see how good enough that the Young Bucks can be as heels. At the same time, I'm not really huge on the Young Bucks, especially, you know, people who just overly mark for the fucking high spots instead of the technical caliber of wrestling.
Right.
And, you know, going up against people like Jurassic Express, don't get me wrong, it's not bad, but you would figure they would be up against serious competition. Not saying that Jurassic Park isn't serious competition, but
Jurassic Park.
I was gonna let it go.
Yeah. Whoops.
How much have you been drinking tonight?
Well, I had a couple Coors Lights, and now I'm just
fuck Coors Light.
That's what Tommy Rich was drinking, Coors Light, yesterday.
Ew, that tastes like aluminum.
Well, I like the fact that, you know, JR was like directing his commentary at poor Marco Stunt by either calling him annoying or a rat.
He is a rat.
But yeah, other than that, you know, if the Hardy Boys and High Voltage had a baby, it would be the Young Bucks. Let's just put it that way. This match wasn't bad. I mean, I definitely agree with DVD Freak. I think this would have been a good opening match, like a good opening tag team match. Instead, we're stuck in a dentist office. You know, God forbid, remind me that I have an appointment in like a month. Like, thanks a lot.
Don't stick yourself with Novocaine.
Other than that, the worst has yet to come. So, Rick, take it away, my friend.
Well, like I said, now I was just seeing that I lied because I walked in as I was turning on the show. This match was on the next match. The Battle Royal was ending. So Lance Archer won the Battle Royal, defeating Eddie Kingston. So I didn't see the Battle Royal. Winner gets a title match. Is that one? Yep. I thought this match usually showed up on the pre-show, about the casino battle royal thing for like the last 2 years, hasn't it?
Yeah.
If I remember.
Yeah.
But this one was moved to the main show.
I'm a sucker for battle royals. I am.
It's old school.
Yeah, I love battle royals, but this was just. This was a clusterfuck. You had Matt Sydal as the Joker entry. You know, that mystery. Did you see his botch?
No, I heard about it.
Oh my god. There's a moment where you're like, well, he's dead. It was really stupid, too, because obviously that's Evan Bourne. He was known for the Shooting Star Press. And he somehow botched the Shooting Star Press. So I don't know if he did a lot of cocaine before this match or what, but
he's getting older. He can't, you know, he's also suffering a number of injuries. So
he's also a humongous drug addict too. So
still, even to this day,
is Darby Allin looking for a death wish in this match too? Because what the fuck was with him taking an insane bump?
Oh, that was bad.
He took like an insane head bump with. You know, while in a body bag with thumbtacks, I'm like, what the fuck is wrong with them?
There was a moment where I was concerned. I like Darby Allin.
Me too.
Because they basically threw him in a body bag, and then I guess you want to call it a power bomb, somewhat from inside the ring to the outside. That was scary. Like. Wow. That was a bump that I didn't know.
If they put you in a body bag like that, how the fuck is he supposed to fall and protect himself?
Well,
he's in a body bag. He can't see shit.
Well, power to him because he somehow figured it out. That was scary.
Now, just when you think the ridiculousness is over, the Broken Rules match, Matt Hardy and Sammy Guevara. 9 minutes, but it seemed like it was 40. It seemed like it went about 45 minutes. I wanted to. This is the first match I actually watched. This is the first match on the night that I actually watched. Sorry, Dan. Hang on 1 second.
Yeah.
And I got to tell you that when I walked into this, I said, if this is what this show is going to be about, I don't know if I can fucking handle it. And the only thing that kept me going was that I wanted to see the next match that was on the show.
Hell yeah.
This match just went all over the place. They felt what's-his-face, Matt Hardy had injured himself against the, then they rang the bell, and then they fucking continued the fucking match for another 5 fucking minutes. And then they climbed the fucking thing, and Sammy Guevara did that old Shane McMahon thing where he fell 15 feet into, plywood or cardboard or whatever the fuck. It was, Matt Hardy's come to this, and Sammy Guevara, dude, this is a kid that's got all the talent in the world. I don't think he wants to waste his time doing stuff like this and risking his body like this. My opinion. But I hated this match. And like I said, 9 minutes seemed like it went on for fucking ever.
I was kind of confused because at a point it seemed like they legitimately stopped the match. And then they're like, no, we have to continue it. This is a pay-per-view. I think they're going to get a lot of shit for this. Because Hardy, he took one of the... That was a horrible bump.
It was. Do you think they stopped it and then continued because there was a certain planned finish?
I think it's one of those things where they didn't want to disappoint the audience.
Yeah.
Whereas I was
sometimes perfectly... You got to think of your own life or bodily harm. You know what I mean? At that point in time, if you can't always worry about... I mean, a lot of these guys want to go out there and they want to please the audience. But damn, Hardy could have fucking really knocked himself silly. Hitting the concrete the way he did.
I would bet money he has a concussion. And you can't wrestle on a concussion.
No.
So... That was one of the worst bumps I've seen in recent memory, for sure. Like, that was bad. That was horrible. And well, it's no one's fault. It's a freak accident, you know, but still.
Yeah. Well, if he wasn't broken then, he's definitely broken now.
I thought they were, speaking of which, I thought they were doing away with broken Matt Hardy. And then all of a sudden, it's on the, I mean, like, did not watch the last 2 weeks of AEW, which is bad on me because I normally do watch it every single week. But
well, last 2 weeks, I guess. You know something. Speaking of Matt Hardy, I wouldn't be surprised. I mean, this would probably be a concept I would create. I wouldn't be surprised if they created like some type of character of like enhancing his like broken gimmick, but kind of with the personality. Has anybody seen that movie Split?
Yes.
I mean, imagine if they did something like that where you have, you know, Million Dollar Matt, Matt Hardy version 1, Broken Matt, High Voltage Matt, you know.
Okay.
I could see something like that. Like, he could take, like, a serious bump, but he doesn't remember who he is, so he goes through all these alternate personalities, and he's like, I'm this one day, but then he's this the next day.
Dude, I buy that. That's awesome. Because I love version 1 Matt Hardy. That's my favorite Matt Hardy gimmick. Him and Shannon Moore. I love it.
You know what my favorite Matt Hardy gimmick is? Ready? When he's retired. Anyways. I've never been a Hardys fan. I always thought they were just spot monkeys. They did stuff that were, well, not as much Matt as obviously his brother, but
Matt
they always looked like they were gonna break themselves and just die at any moment. So I just said I can't deal with this. So because I'm more into the traditional style, you know, grappling and submission base and all that shit.
I think Matt was always the more he's much more talented than Jeff, and
I think that he's the actual wrestler of the
He team. Has a great mind for wrestling. He really does. He knows what he's doing. He knows psychology. He was just never really given that opportunity to show it.
Right.
So I always... Like,
go ahead, buddy. Sorry.
Yeah, I always liked the Hardys a lot, but Matt was always the clear wrestler, whereas Jeff was the entertainer. Mm-hmm. With all due respect.
He was the guy. He was the guy that got everybody to go holy shit in the crowd.
Yeah.
So I'm watching some wrestling in the background. I have this channel Wrestling, I told you, on my Roku box, and they just have a constant stream of random shit that I just remember when Brian Pillman did the Yellow Dog mimic in WCW, like 92. Anybody know that? Dan does, obviously, the reaction, but when he was feuding with what the fuck is his name? I'm trying to say it. I just said it. Barry Windham.
Yeah,
he's facing Rick Rogers here, the legendary Rick Rogers.
I think that was on the 91 Great American Bash.
I think they wrestled each other. I don't think it was Yellow Dog though. I could be wrong. I think it was definitely Windham and Pillman, but not Pillman as the Yellow Dog. But anyways, see, this channel is pretty fucking awesome because now they go to fucking random Memphis match with the Fabulous Ones. So, that's pretty fucking awesome. So anyways, this is the match that I was looking forward to the most. Let me see if I can pronounce this properly. No offense. Hikaru Shida, the AEW Women's Champion, defeated my favorite wrestler, Thunder Rosa. Much bullshit. But seriously, I thought Thunder Rosa was going to come into AEW and tear up the entire women's division and walk away with the AEW Women's title. But I guess, I thought that she was going to tear it up, take it away. Obviously, in my personal opinion, this shows that she's sticking with the NWA because they're about to premiere their new show in, 2 weeks? Approximately? A week? Something like that? So, I'm looking forward to that, definitely, the new NWA show that's going to be starting up. That's going to be, I can already tell you, the Major Wrestling Network Championship Wrestling from Hollywood and the NWA working all together. It's going to be my favorite show of the week. Absolutely.
Well, absolutely. Let me tell you, just
the name itself, and like knowing the history and those company as it is. So I'm glad to see the NWA be up and running again. But this match was disappointing, but it was pretty good. Common theme from what I'm seeing here is that this pay per view was just kind of lackluster so far.
I even texted you earlier saying, "Oh, the card looks good."
You know, earlier today. You're like, this is a stacked show.
Yeah.
And I was looking forward to it. I always look forward to every AEW pay-per-view, to be honest with you.
So do I.
Because I always think that they do really great shows, even their television shows. You know what I mean? It's not always, there's not like 100% distinct difference. They're just, as far as like clear product, they always just put 100% into both products, you know what I mean? It's just that pay-per-view is just that much better, like match quality-wise, but this match, you can just see in here, this match, how long did it go? 17 minutes. It's pretty decent runtime. I like longer matches, but it just seemed like it went on a little bit too long. Even though I like longer matches for this particular match, it just seemed like it went on too long.
Well, it's a problem when a 17-minute long match never kicks it into third gear. That's the issue.
And what is that problem? What do you think, honestly, is that problem? Because, I mean, obviously, they're continuing with the same format that they've been doing on Dynamite since the pandemic started. Empty arena. Now there was some people in the crowd, right? In the upper levels?
Yeah.
So, there's nothing like that crowd noise, like making people pop. Like that thing, that just doesn't seem to get going this entire event. If you get what I'm saying, Freak?
Well, can you even hear the crowd? Like,
there's that too, but you can always, throughout the weeks that we've been watching AEW and the wrestlers, the guy have been around the ring, those guys in the first row or two, you can always hear them cheering. Tonight seemed just a little bit different.
Well, my question to you is, let's say this pay-per-view was an arena with 15,000 people. Would the pay-per-view have been better?
That's a really good question. that Deader's a really good. It's not one that answered because, I mean, on paper, it looks like a really great show.
Yeah.
It's just not, the match quality is not delivering. Could that match quality have been jumped up a little bit with the crowd reactions? I mean, the crowd played a very big part into professional wrestling.
Well, the example I always give is The Rock and Hogan. That's not a great match. But look what the crowd did to that match. So,
I mean, that's Hogan, one of Hogan, you know, that was his, you know, he's come back to where he was made. And it's a big deal, that match.
Yeah, a crowd.
I would not buy a ticket solely based on that one match, though. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but that just goes to show you a crowd can elevate a match.
Absolutely.
Not quality-wise, but... Right. It can make you, it can immerse you into the match more.
Daniel, what do you have to say?
Well, about this women's match, I would say if this match was served as a tryout match for Thunder Rosa, she definitely passed with flying fucking colors. Let's just put it that way.
Yeah, I think she was on this past week's show. I think she wrestled, which I still got to catch up on that. It's on my DVR.
You know, and another thing too is AEW gives all these women every opportunity to have the match of the night to this point. And I mean, they pretty much lived up to it. I mean, I would probably say this was probably maybe the best match of the night from what I was seeing.
I'm going to give you that. Up to this point, I will say that this is the best match.
Yeah, I wouldn't say best.
There is one that I feel is better. It's not the match that I was expecting to be the best match of the night. That's the other thing. And I think I texted you that earlier, DVD proof. Or something similar to that. So the next match is an 8-man tag match. I'm a sucker for like 8-man, 10-man tags. You don't see them enough anymore. Back when we were growing up in the 80s, they used to pop up every now and again. Now AEW doesn't a little bit, more often than the other guys do. But Matt Cardona, Scorpio Sky, and the Natural Nightmares, Dustin Rhodes and QT Marshall, against the Dark Order, Brody Lee, Colt Cabana, Evil Uno, and Stu Grayson. This is another dud, dude. What I did like about it was Dustin Rhodes' blue gear and the blue makeup. I thought there was something different for that than the something very awesome. I mean, I love the red, but the blue, there was something really fucking cool looking about it.
Well, let's put it this way. He's 21 years late for the blue dust character.
Did you realize he was using his old, not his old, like 2013 gold dust paint, but it was blue?
Actually, I didn't even pay attention.
I
was looking at the colors like meshing together, like how they look together. The face paint was actually.
It was the same design as like 2014, 13, when he was teaming with Cody. It was the same design, but a different color. So that was most likely because. The way I look at it, maybe I'm looking too far into this, but Cody's obviously kayfabe injured right now. He's out. So that could have been seen as a nice little tribute to, you know, their tag team days back when they were tag team champions in WWE.
You know what I got to say about you about that? God, you're a fucking nerd.
Yes.
You picked that up out of nowhere.
Yes. I pay attention to detail. Yes.
No, go ahead. Yeah, you seem like you have more to say.
It was as a fan of Goldust, it's cool to see that little Easter egg, if you want to call it that.
Okay.
So, and that promo that Dustin gave after the match was just
that was amazing.
Oh my god,
amazing! The match itself was mediocre at best. But this was one of the better matches of the night so far. Like, literally, it did get better as time went on, but it just was not pay-per-view level. And I don't want to offend the team. I'm not a wrestler, so I don't really have much, say, or I'm just some guy sitting in front of Skype talking to my buddies. It just seemed like it was local indie wrestling going to watch in a high school gym or something like that. Like, it was like just maybe like a step, like a level above that. Damn, wake up.
You know what? I mean, anybody else think that Colt and Brody are a very underrated couple, like pairing, odd couple pairing?
They have good chemistry when they were arguing. Like they can act off of one another.
I think Brody's pretty fucking amazing, and the fact that he's actually getting to shine after not being able to shine for a number of years, it's pretty fucking awesome. You know, and Colt is one of those guys that could just do work with anybody, and it's enjoyable to watch. I'm a huge Colt Cabana fan.
I like him most of the time. When he's not, when he's taking himself seriously, I like him.
Oh, okay. Yeah, because you're not a comedy guy. I don't think he really does that much comedy anymore. I think,
yeah.
Even still, if he's doing the comedy, the guy can show off that he is a really good catch-as-catch-can wrestler. I mean, I compare him to, but not equal to, God, you guys are going to fucking kill me for this, Steven Regal. But like, as far as style goes, like I said,
okay.
I compare him to his style, his flow in the ring, just not equal to. And he'd even say, admit that he was he modeled himself as like a catch-as can wrestler. But there's some comedy in there as well. But it seems like over the years, it's also lightened up the comedy. But he always is one of those guys that goes out there and looks like he's having fun no matter what.
Even if he's Scotty Goldman.
Oh, God. Poor guy. Poor guy.
Oh, so, boy.
This next match. Jesus fucking Christ. 29 minutes and 40 seconds. A fucking half hour.
God.
This should have been match of the fucking night. Okay? Congratulations to FTR. I love you guys. One of my favorite modern tag teams.
For sure.
Oh, what the actual fuck was going on? And they kept going and going and going for half a fucking hour.
Went
on forever, and I was like, is this over yet? When the fuck is this going to end?
This is an example of a match that never leaves second gear and still goes 29 minutes.
Yeah.
You never had that really exciting moment of, oh, when's the pinfall going to come? Mm. Like, it felt like almost two separate matches. I don't know if you caught it, like, right in the middle. It felt like it was going to end. And then they started, like, working the leg again. Yeah, they started working.
Yes, I know exactly where you're talking about. Yeah,
and I'm just like, did we start a second match? Like, the pacing of this match was awful.
Yeah, and why is that? Like, these guys are professionals. I mean, obviously, these guys went from anywhere from New Japan to Ring of Honor to fucking WWE. Some of these guys, like, what is going on here? And it took a half an hour. This is a match that could have gone 10 to 15 minutes and gotten the point across. I mean, I'm a sucker for matches that go for half hour or an hour. Iron Man matches, as long as they're fucking intense. And I think that this is definitely a match that maybe the crowd should have been there. They should have saved this half hour, 30 minute match for when there was a live crowd to go that fucking long and to deliver what they were trying to deliver tonight.
Yeah, I fully believe this would have been approved upon by having a crowd that was into it.
Absolutely.
This is one of those matches that clearly was hurt by the circumstances. It's not a bad match at all.
No,
but
it's not. Absolutely not. It's just it didn't deliver the way it should have.
Did have really good storytelling, though. I will give it that. Between Kenny and Hangman, you had that great storytelling. And but the problem is storytelling takes a crowd to absorb that storytelling.
Right.
It's kind of just awkward when you have storytelling to silence. So this was just, it was an awkward match.
Maybe they should have mic'd those few people that were in the upper levels. They should have put, you know, they should have mic'd the crowd a little bit. You get what I'm saying? To try to get a little bit better reaction to pick up on camera.
Well, the problem is, if you remember when Jericho came out, they were all singing his theme music, and that was pretty loud. So yeah. I feel like they could have, I feel like they turned the mics on for that. So they could have turned the mics on for this. And I think what? It's 10% capacity, if I'm correct.
Is that what it was?
Okay. Something I read.
I thought it was something like 30, but I could be mixing up the story. So
I feel like it's too quiet for 30.
Speaking of Jericho, he lost to Orange Cassidy in a, how do you fucking say it? Mimosa Mayhem match.
Whatever.
Yeah. Please fuck yourselves. Like, seriously. This was the most ridiculous concept on the face of the earth, and it went 15 fucking minutes just to get dunked in a fucking pile or a tank of mimosa. I literally never thought that I'd see Orange Cassidy get as big as he is. Being an indie darling, or however you want to say it, you know. But the gimmick, I never really expected to get over the way that it did. And then now he's, I mean, look at this. Chris Jericho put him over. Which, has that make him look? That makes him look amazing. And that means that he's fucking set for a very long time. You know, it's going to make the character.
Well, this was the...
Make him as a wrestler.
This was their third match, too. And if I'm correct, this was 2 out of 3 for Cassidy, right?
Yeah, I believe so. I believe you're right.
So that's a pretty big jump start right there. Not jump start. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, like, that's huge for Jericho to put you over 2 out of 3. That's huge.
Yeah, he must believe in him that Cassidy is going to be something someday. I mean, honestly, I don't think that Cassidy is going to be on the level with Moxley doing that same character. They're obviously going to have to change his character down the road somehow, or alter it somehow, if that's what, you know, Jericho is setting him up for, to be a headliner in a major company like this. I mean, in obviously Jericho putting him over is setting him up for that. My opinion. And
is it just me, or the for character of pacing, for pacing the character of Orange Cassidy, I feel like they had him talk too much too soon. I really believe.
I don't know, because I've been watching him a long time.
Well, yeah.
Long, you know, a couple years. So I'm like.
But let's look at the average.
He hasn't really done much in AEW in order to be talking that much.
Yeah. Yeah.
But, you know, it's like, I didn't see the episode where he had the debate with Jericho, and I saw that skit tonight, and I was like, holy shit, he's talking way too much than he probably should be. So maybe you're right.
But when he did talk, it was brilliant. I will say that.
It was. Yeah.
So I definitely, it was kind of a love-hate thing, because I'm like, it's too gimmicky, but at the same time, it's kind of a genius gimmick.
Mm-hmm.
It's so bad that it works in a really good way. So I'm interested in seeing where Orange Cassidy goes from here. I really am. And I never thought I'd say that, because I was never a big fan of him.
I think Dan knows how I feel about Orange Cassidy, or felt at one point. Because I used to talk shit about Orange Cassidy, because, you know, it was like, I was, it's killing the business, basically. I mean, not the business is already dead, and the kayfabe's already dead, but you get what I'm saying? It's like, you don't need guys like him coming in and then sulking the business just because the fucking kayfabe's dead.
I agree.
But I think this feud with Jericho is really what got me opening my fucking mind and saying, you know what? This guy's actually not too bad. Once I actually started to see him actually wrestle a little bit more. I mean, don't I saw him in Beyond Wrestling and a couple other indies. I never really thought much of him. I just hated the fucking gimmick. But I think that it was him working with Jericho is that what convinced me finally, and I saw what every other person was speaking of. Daniel, DVD Freak stepped down on us. Probably going to piss, but go ahead.
Well, you know what? I mean, despite how much of a big win this was for Orange Cassidy, I also find this as a blow-off, kind of a conclusion for Jericho to partake in the next feud of putting a new generation superstar over.
Yeah.
Other than that, I mean, as much as I like Jericho, I feel like he's just dwindled down and not as much taking his career seriously as he was back when he was in WWE or New Japan. I think he finally found like a platform where it's like, okay, I'm finally 50, you know, I'm doing all this stuff with music, you know, setting up cruise tours and everything, and he's having like the most ridiculous rivalries. I mean, if you recall, you know, just a couple months ago, the one with Matt Hardy, and, you know, he got fucking Matt Hardy's drone or whatever, and he's all like, "Oh, release the hounds!" and all these fucking Like, don't get me wrong. Jericho's very comical, which I don't mind in wrestling, but I feel like comedy should be played more within storytelling rather than inside the ring. But I feel like Jericho taking the loss here today would be like the conclusion into launching Orange Cassidy onto that next level.
You ready to hear something else? In the 30 years, almost 30 years I've been watching Jericho, I've never been sold on Jericho. Isn't that crazy? I never thought that he was as good as people made him out to be. I remember the first time I ever saw him, my friend showed me a VHS tape. You got to check this guy out. It was him against Benoit in Japan, I believe. I'm like, I don't see it, but I see Benoit. You know what I mean? Because he knew I was a huge Benoit guy. But it wasn't until, like, his later years that, like, and I still, I mean, I like Jericho. It's just not, he's not, to me, he's not Arn Anderson or Benoit, Bret Hart, Owen Hart. Like, those are my favorite guys, you know what I mean? But I think that Jericho has a good mind. I think his attitude, he's kind of a dick as well.
Thank you. Oh, my God.
Do you listen to his podcast?
Yeah, I do.
I listen to it, and he just comes off as arrogant sometimes. While I do enjoy his interviews, especially when he does things that are outside of professional wrestling, or maybe something that's either music related, or he's had what the hell, that guy that did the some sort of supernatural documentary series or something, or documentary for Amazon or something. I forgot what his name was. He has like guys like that, like movie filmmakers and shit like that on his show sometimes. Those are interesting episodes. Sometimes it's his, he's a good person. He's a good person to be doing an interview. He's just not very, I don't know.
He's not very humble.
Yeah, exactly. He's not very humble. Like, he definitely thinks who he is. And he pissed me off one day when one of the earlier episodes of AEW when they were in Memphis, when people were, he insulted Elvis Presley, saying the Beatles are better than Elvis. So go fuck yourself, Chris, because that's not true. Elvis is the king of rock and roll, and we all know that's true.
Well, so, I'll tell you what, Fozzy is nothing but modern generic shit. So I'll say that right now.
I think everybody knows that, but I mean, the Beatles are fucking probably, they may have sold more records than any band alive or band around. They're definitely not the greatest rock and roll band that ever existed.
Well, it's like Hogan. He put more asses in seats than anyone, but that doesn't make him the greatest wrestler of all time.
That's true.
You know what?
I'm not going to say that I don't like the Beatles. I just think they're terribly overrated. They've got abundance of good songs.
They're good.
Not the greatest rock and roll. You know who's better than them? You take Sgt. Pepper's. I'm sorry, Dan. You take Sgt. Pepper's compared to the first Pink Floyd album. You'll walk away with the Pink Floyd album thinking it's a better album. pre-David Gilmore, pre-David Gilmore, Piper at the Gates of Dawn, pre-David Gilmore, Pink Floyd.
Fair enough.
So anyways, Daniel, I'm sorry I cut you off. I just wanted to get my point across about how much I dislike the Beatles.
I agree. I'm not a big fan of them either.
As much as of a conceited asshole Jericho is.
Why are we trashing
I'll never forget the time there was a VHS release for WWF, and it was a Chris Jericho VHS that came out in 2000, and it never came out on DVD. And while he was doing music, he went under this alter ego named Mongoose McQueen. And basically, he was trying to sit there and convince people, I'm not Chris Jericho. I don't know what you're talking about. But clearly, it was fucking him. But he was going under this alter ego named Mongoose McQueen.
Was he trying to pass as, like, Steve McQueen's son or something? Like,
You know what? I wouldn't be surprised if he mentioned something like that. But, like, I remember just, like, watching that VHS tape, and it was just, like, going over all his rivalries at that time.
What the fuck?
He had Howard Finkel as, like, number two or number three Jerichoholic. Like, he actually counted the number of his fans. And then the whole bullshit, I was just like, really? Like,
He's an interesting character, but like DVD Freak said, he's not very humble. You listen to his what the hell's his name is his podcast? Talk is Jericho, right?
Jericho.
The episode where he started talking about his high school bands—that's a fucking hilarious episode. And the following week, I think he brings in a tape. He plays a tape of one of his high school bands. It's fucking hilarious. It's like talking about the concept of forming an '80s metal band. As teenagers, it's just fucking hilarious stuff. Especially if you grew up in the '80s and got a lot of the references.
One thing I will say about him is he really does respect the wrestling business.
He does, absolutely.
And probably my favorite episode / interview he ever did was Sandra Toffolini, I think her. I don't want to butcher her name, but it's Nancy Benoit's sister.
I heard that one. I was.
Oh my god! Yeah,
that's a good episode.
Yeah. That episode is gold, and you know what?
It came out only a year before she popped up on Dark Side of the Ring. Maybe.
It was in 2017 because he did it for the 20th or not 20th, the 10th anniversary.
She must have come on again because she. Wait. How long did you say she came on for the what anniversary?
They filmed it in January, and then he aired it in June for the 10th anniversary.
Okay, she must have been on right before the episode Dark Side of the Ring, probably maybe a year prior she was on again. But I think he knew her because he was friends with Benoit, too. So.
But I respected that because he literally didn't really speak the entire episode. He let her take over, and I respect that. You know, he knows how to do an interview.
And he didn't He just doesn't really judge Benoit either. That's the other thing.
Yeah,
he gives his opinion. I mean, that was his buddy, you know. But is you know, like I said, like he comes off as arrogant. He's not very humble. I do like him. I just don't think he's nearly as great as he thinks he himself is. Same thing with Hogan. You know, Hogan's another guy that thinks he's the greatest on earth and the shit don't stand. But
yeah,
if I walked into any of them in the fucking street, I'd probably fucking mark out. But
I think Jericho's a genius, but he's not that much of a genius as he thinks he is. He thinks he's the Einstein of wrestling, whereas I'm like, no. He's great with storytelling and psychology.
Right.
But I would never put him on the top 10 list of greatest of all time. And I'm sure he'd put himself at number one. Let's be honest. So.
Maybe top 100, maybe. He'd fit somewhere in there, probably.
Yeah.
In the lower 50.
I completely agree. I've met people that say he's the greatest of all time. And I'm like, really?
No.
He's great.
I do own a Jericho shirt. maybe actually two of them. But, you know, I don't. And I enjoy his work in Japan. I enjoy his work, you know, the little bit that he was in Smoky Mountain. Even some WWF, but I don't think he's the top tier as he on the tier that he thinks he is.
Well, you know what I own? I own the Road is Jericho DVD.
Uh-oh.
Where he sat in a limousine for 6 hours and talked about his career.
Jesus Christ. It's not actually 6 hours long, is it? The whole
DVD? Sorry. It's 7 hours.
Jesus fucking Christ. I don't know. I mean, there's certain guys I'd probably like to sit there and listen to their careers for 7 hours. You know, Ric Flair would not be one of them because I've heard his story a million times. Even that fucking, that 8-disc fucking shoot interview he did with High Spots a number of years ago. You know, so it's like I've heard his story a million times. Steamboat might be a guy that I'd want to sit there for. But there's also other guys that I'd like to sit and talk with for so many hours about wrestling that I can't. You know, one of the people, and I always bring him up, regarding the Chaos, Big Daddy, every time I sit there and talk to him, especially talking about wrestling in New England and his career in professional wrestling and the history in New England, it's a fucking amazing conversation because I just love the history, especially of our area. Of professional wrestling.
The person that I had brought up to you that I wanted to have on, he's the exact same way. Once you get in a conversation with him, he just has some of the greatest stories, and like he knows so much about it. He worked at a time when it was the best time to be in the indies. And it's just like, I could sit there for hours. Like, there was one time I was getting a tattoo done. My girlfriend was doing a tattoo for me, which I actually got 2 new tattoos today. But that's besides the fact. She was literally doing, like, a tattoo for, like, 2 hours. And he was just sitting there telling me wrestling stories the whole time. That's amazing. It was just fucking awesome.
I could sit there forever and talk wrestling. Honestly, yesterday I met Tommy Rich, and I only got to speak to him for, like, you know, a couple minutes. I probably had a million questions in my head, but once I stepped up to him and shook his hand, I forgot everything that I ever wanted to say to the guy. I should have asked him about the time he sat under the fucking ring in Memphis drinking beer for an entire show to interfere and attack Lawler in the main event. But
you should have also asked him why he chose Coors Light out of any other beer. But
I have
a hatred for Coors Light, guys.
Well, I'm going to tell you one thing that I got to say. And I'm usually pretty nice to you, but you can go fuck yourself. Because I'll drink that on a hot summer day any day.
Well, right now,
smooth and easy.
Right now, I'm drinking a Miller Genuine Draft.
Is it really genuine? That's the question.
Probably not, but it's good, so I'll take it.
You know, we've talked about 4 or 5 different subjects, including saying our dislike for Jericho. And then our love for Jericho at the same time. We are some dicks. But we got off track and have not even discussed the main event, Jon Moxley and MJF. God, these two could fucking work. But I think this could have been so much better fucking match. I liked it a whole hell of a lot. And you know, my favorite part was that fucking MJF bladed and he was just gushing blood for quite a while. And then later in the match, when he started to clear up after they started swapping headbutts, he started gushing more blood again. Mm-hmm. It was, this is a match that I think would have really went over really well had it been a packed arena. I really honestly think that, as was most of the matches this evening.
I love how there were MJF signs all around the arena, too.
I loved his new gear that were geared towards the MJF 2020 gear. I think it was awesome, dude. Yeah.
You mean his Apollo Creed gear that he had going on?
The American flag. He's running the president, whatever, the political, like, fights and stuff. Yep.
Do you? Awesome. Do you think it was the right decision to have Moxley retain tonight? That's my question for you guys.
Clear.
Of course you don't. Of course you don't, you fucking mark. I'm sorry, Dad. You know, is MJF ready to be that guy? I think the guy's got all the talents in the world, and I think he's the greatest heel in professional wrestling.
Yep.
In years, and he's the most legit, and the guy lives it outside of professional wrestling, you know, whether he's going to autograph signings or whatever, he plays the character, he's always in character.
Yep.
I think he's a great, so he is keeping kayfabe alive. Shit. I would have liked to have seen him win the title. I really would have. I mean, you know, it's just, and I think he's going to get there. I definitely think it's definitely going to come. But it's like, against Moxley, I don't know. I can't answer that. It would have been really, I think if he defeated Moxley, it would have bumped him up on a whole nother fucking level. You know, Moxley's been to the top in the biggest company in the world on a couple different occasions. You know what I mean? So, defeating somebody like Moxley, that probably would have boosted him up quite a bit.
Well, there's a pay-per-view in November now that's confirmed. So,
yeah,
they might be waiting. They might be waiting for November.
You think they didn't announce that match, did they?
No.
No, but they also had 2 months to build it, right?
Yeah, they announced, I think it's Full Gear, I think. Which I almost went to that last year. I regret not going. It was literally 45 minutes away from me. I should have went. But, yeah, I think it's Full Gear in November.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, November is obviously election month, if I'm correct. I'm not political, so you guys can answer that.
You're correct.
So, that could be a good time. They might be waiting to put the belt on him for that. Just to add to it.
Right. I think that the guy is definitely a future world champion.
Sure.
Yeah. I think he's definitely a face. I mean, I don't ever see him turning baby face. I think his character is perfect the way he is.
So, I think they're
just lighting it up too much. I'll be right
here's
back.
My keep question. Okay. All
right.
Yep.
Here's my question. If we're having election month within the next couple of months. You think they're going to have some stupid match stipulation where it's like, okay, if MJF can't win the belt fairly, they're going to have this type of stipulation where it's like, all right, everybody vote on who do you want to have as the new AEW World Champion.
Oh, and God. Don't say that.
No. I never know nowadays.
We had a bad night. Please don't further it. Oh, man. But, yeah, this dude, he is the future. Seriously. He is one of those guys you can put the belt on him for years, and he will work as a heel. 100%.
That's a good answer. That's a good response. I think that is absolutely true.
I like longer title reigns, personally.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah, 100%. You're right.
And as much as I appreciate Moxley holding the title belt this long, I think it's. I think his time's coming. I think he needs to drop it soon. I really do. I like Jon Moxley, but I just think it's. I think it's his time to drop it. Like I don't think he really has much more to bring to the table. Honestly,
do you think that Moxley needs the title?
No, he doesn't. He doesn't. He really doesn't.
You think he's accomplished too much outside of his company that he doesn't really need it? Do you think the AEW gave him the belt because he was a named wrestler?
I think Moxley at this point, given his reputation and everything, he's an attraction. Whereas MJF, I feel like he could bring legitimacy to the title.
You think Moxley's an attraction?
To modern fans, yes. Not people like us, but to modern fans, yes. Because you have to look at it. He left WWE.
That's interesting. Like, do you think he's like like you said, he left WWE. Do you think he's like the big former WWE guy that is headlining indies type guy? Not that he is, but type guy. You get what I'm saying here?
Yeah. I completely think he will be popular without the title. Whereas MJF, I feel like I said, he could bring legitimacy to the AEW title. Not the third.
I think AEW needs that, because I mean, look at the first champion.
Yeah. So I would love.
So basically, right off the bat, right there, there's two former WWE guys right away. There's no homegrown talent or, you know, talent from elsewhere. It's all WWE. It's so far been two WWE guys.
So I say give it to MJF for fucking 2 years, and then have him drop it to the next big baby face.
You think MJF should handle it like Flair did?
Yeah.
Going back and forth. You think he's future, say, 16-time world champion?
No, I wouldn't say 16 times. But no. I think I will. The thing about Ric Flair is he's a 16-time world champion, but he also lost it how many times? Like,
well, he's not necessarily even a 16-time world champion.
It's more than numbers. That. But...
Yeah, it is, because he lost it to what's, you know, he lost it to what's his name in Dominican Republic. Jack something.
Yeah.
Which is the NWA does not credit that as well, because he just decided to lose the belt on his own because he didn't think he'd walk out alive out of the arena. So there's so many stories like that, you know, or random little changes that have happened else, like, yeah. So anyways.
But my question to you is, let's say MJF holds a title for a long period of time. Do you think we have that baby face now that he's going to drop it to? Or do you think it's somebody way in the future that we don't even know about right now?
You think if he wins the title, he'll drop it to... Actually, shit, now I'm thinking about it. Who the fuck will he defeat in AEW?
I mean, Cody, Adam Page...
go for the title, correct? Cody,
well, I wouldn't...
If they actually stick with that bullshit.
I wouldn't want him as champion. And I respect Cody a lot, but come on. You can't suck your own dick. Like,
I think Cody has sucked it quite a bit on AEW television. you know, he really has. I mean, especially, look at all the bullshit that he's done. But, you know, the thing is that he doesn't even, you know, admit his own faults. I think he's a product of his environment. I mean, I love Big Dusty, wearing a Dusty shirt. But, you know, he's a product of his father. Like, he, you know, Dusty booked himself to be whatever he was, and Cody's doing the same exact thing.
Yeah.
If you look at it that way.
Yeah.
Pretty.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think Cody should ever be the world champion in AEW. I thought the TNT title should have actually gone on longer with him.
I was surprised that it actually ended up dropping it, to be honest with you. I thought that was going to go on longer. It seemed like it was because he kept random indie talent kept popping up in that he was facing. I was like, oh, then it ended up being Brody Lee. You know, so I think going back to what you were saying about who would be the good baby face to take it off? MJF. I think Adam Page is a good choice.
That's who I was going to say, yeah.
I thought he was going to beat Jericho. I thought he was going to be the first champion, because I was just like,
yeah.
The first pay-per-view where they won that Battle Royal, I was like, Jericho's, one of the first things I said about it was, Jericho's going to do the right thing and make this kid a star, and he's going to walk away with the title. And it didn't end up happening, and I just remember saying, "You fucking cocksucker!" Like, you arrogant cocksucker! Like, when I saw him be the first champion, I was like, "I can't believe you fucking did that shit." But at the same time, you know, I think that I love AEW, but that's one of the downfalls. It's a little bit too much control for certain people.
Well, let's look at it this way. Let's say 20 years from now, AEW obviously has a history at that point. Who can they say their inaugural champion was? Chris Jericho.
Right.
So, in the long run, it'll help them, but short term, it didn't do too much. I wanted Paige to win, but I'm like, they're not going to have him win yet. There's no way. Right. Jericho was going to win to bring legitimacy to the title. Jesus, right. Fuck. But there's two sides of the argument. Do you put it on someone that's already legitimate, or do you put it on somebody that's up and coming? So there's literally two sides of that argument.
I want to go back a minute about the first hour of the show. Legendary WCW talent Bob Cook. I grabbed this quote from his Facebook page. It was the match I said I watched first was a Matt Hardy Sammy Guevara. The match between Matt Hardy and that Sammy Guevara goof was beyond embarrassing proof once again that no matter how long you've been in the business, if you're willing to be a clown, then you should just join the goddamn circus.
Ooh, that's
Bob's got some of the greatest quotes. He watches. He was not very well known. He's trained by Great Malenko, he worked with Dean and his brother Joe, and worked in the Florida territory before coming to WCW and being an handsome talent. I'm friends with him on Facebook, and he follows professional wrestling today, WWE, AEW, everything. And he really him going and talking on Facebook just about professional wrestling, posting about it. The guy keeps up really well, and he really knows what the fuck he's talking about. And this quote I take very seriously. I think it's very accurate.
I know the past few days it's kind of been in the headlines that Matt Hardy was pissed that Vince McMahon wanted to make him basically a road agent and a producer, and that they didn't believe in him as an in-ring performer. And I was like, you know what? As much as I respect the Hardys,
because of his age, you think? Like, he's getting up there, and Vince can't do anything with him anymore? Like, basically, is that what
I think at this point, Matt Hardy brings more to the table as a wrestling mind than someone that's in the ring.
Right.
So, you're probably right. Like, what else is he going to bring to AEW? Let's be honest. What is he actually going to draw? Nothing.
Right.
No one's going to buy a ticket or buy a pay-per-view because Matt Hardy. I hate saying that, but it's 2020, guys. Like,
I hear what you're saying. I'm picking up what you're putting down. It makes sense. He's at that point in his career. He could just... But, there's obviously some love for the business that he wants to be an active wrestler still.
Of course, yeah.
That's the shame of it. Like, that happens with some guys. Sometimes it's more money being the active wrestler than being the agent, because look at Ric Flair. Wrestler Curly was like, what, 60 something years old? Because he had no choice. He had no choice but to, because of past bills and all that other shit.
But I don't think money's much of an issue for Matt Hardy. And it's one of those things where
loves the business that much that he just wants to continue to be an active talent.
It's like a TV show that runs way too long. A TV show should always end in its prime.
Yeah.
And you don't want to see a TV show. There's only one example I can think of, Breaking Bad. One of my favorite shows. That ended on top.
Yeah.
And I think Matt Hardy is starting to become a joke. He needs to end it while you can, before you tarnish your legacy.
There's always plenty of guys out there that do that. Tarnish their legacy, working in decades, you know what I mean?
Well, it's like, how many times has Terry Funk fucking retired? Like
75, I think, to be exact.
Is it really that many?
No, I have no idea. I just made that up.
It's just you should always,
He's had a million retirement matches. That's the other thing, Terry Funk. But, he was old back when I was watching him in the 80s. You know? He was, what, 50 in the 80s, 40-something in the 80s, something like that?
End your career while you're still remembered is legitimate. You don't want to become a joke. You don't. Yeah. It's just, it's sad because, like I said, I like Matt Hardy. He's very intelligent.
Yeah.
He knows what he's doing. But I think if he goes on too much longer, he's just going to become a puppet as opposed to that great wrestling mind that a lot of people think of him as.
Daniel, you've been awfully quiet for the last, I don't know, entire show. Do you have anything to offer?
I mean, the way I put it, I mean, when it comes to legitimacy for the AEW world title, I mean, I'm not saying that MJF doesn't deserve it, but I feel like there's a lot more progression into his character that we haven't seen yet. And I think something that we're probably going to have to witness till October, November, until the next pay-per-view. Right. Another thing, I mean, I have no problem with seeing Moxley holding the title, but let's put it this way. Yes, he doesn't need the title to, you know, be legitimate, you know, need legitimacy as, like, a top big talent, because when he got released last year, you know, I was at the first independent show that he was booked for NEW. Everybody bought tickets because Moxley was there.
It was the hottest free agent at that time.
You know, people weren't buying tickets because it was like, oh, shit, he's going to be in a title match. No, he was going up against Darby Allin. It's like, I mean, pretty much says it right there. I mean, and then, you know, New Japan started to utilize him, and they were like, all right, you know, let's give you the treatment that WWE never gave you. He was the last guy to hold the WWE championship, so what does that tell you? Out of all members of the Shield.
The way I look at it is, would CM Punk be nearly as popular as he is today if he wouldn't have left on his own terms? That's the way I look at John Moxley. He left on his own terms. He quit. He rebelled.
Right.
So that's why he will always be that stigma. That he will always be that attraction as the guy who left at the time when the WWE product was garbage.
Right.
So that's why I say he doesn't need the title.
Right.
Well, I only say it this way because whether Punk would have received the WWE championship or not, I mean, he did leave an impact when he cut that pipe bomb. I mean, nobody's really done promos like that before. I mean, we've gotten a few hints and a few, like, off-script moments, maybe during, like, the Attitude Era and, you know, just people speaking their minds. But when it came to, you know, CM Punk actually just sitting down in front of the crowd and, you know, just basically disowning the boss and basically just living up to the facts, like, oh, you know, it's going to be controlled by your daughter and your idiotic, stupid son-in-law. I mean,
who's the idiot out of the two? Let's be serious.
To be exact, it's the douchebag son-in-law.
Douchebag son-in-law. But yeah, I mean, it's all built off of frustrations. And I mean, if you're not expressing your frustrations, I mean, you're only going to be as locked in as a TV dinner. I mean, let's just put it that way.
That's a JR reference, right? That sounds like a JR simile.
That's the second time TV dinners have come up tonight. I think I'm going to go make something. Jesus Christ.
I am hungry.
With the whole Matt Hardy thing, the way I see it, he really doesn't have nothing much to... He doesn't have anything to prove. Him just doing these matches are just Matt Hardy being Matt Hardy. I mean, this was the lifestyle that he grew up with. I mean, back in the day, you know, he did like the Trampoline Wrestling Federation. He basically founded his own organization before being trained properly. So taking bumps like this is probably nothing to him. But obviously,
I also think that his career, it's nearing the end. Like, he's coming in there to do certain things, to work with certain younger people before he just finally retires and does something else in the wrestling business, hoping, you know, does whatever. Gentlemen?
I mean, like I said, I don't think he has much to bring. It's like Jeff in WWE. Like, what's he doing right now? Isn't he like Intercontinental champ? Is he champion right now?
That's a good question. I know he was. You know, I got to tell you, say one thing. I'm going to make a statement. Somebody messaged me today. And actually, they called me on the telephone. First off, if you're listening, nobody better ever fucking call me at 8:30 in the morning. All right? I'm still sleeping, especially on a Saturday or a fucking Sunday, because I wake up every fucking morning.
Fuck yeah.
Yeah. Do not ever call me just to ask me if I've watched SmackDown last night or if I've watched Raw last night.
Who the fuck did that?
We'll talk off here. But they have another podcast. I'm going to tell you something. I've said this on my show. It's obvious that they don't fucking listen to this show. Because I've stated, how many times have I said to the both of you and JJ that I haven't watched Raw or SmackDown in fucking months? Right?
That's better than me.
Well, I can't. I can't bring myself to it. Every time I attempt it, within a half hour, maybe I'll get an hour into it, but I'm just like, what the fuck am I doing here?
Yep.
Don't ask me. And then they just, and you know what they wanted to fucking talk about? It was a fucking Sasha Banks face turn. I was like, this is what you're fucking calling me for?
She turned face?
Or something like that. Okay. That's what...
That doesn't make much sense, but all right.
WWE doesn't make sense, and neither does this fucking phone call. And the fact that they called and they said, "Oh, it was a great episode." First off, you're probably on crack if you think it was a great episode. You're a cocksucker if you thought it was a great episode. And you need to start drinking more, because I can't stand the product. It's the most obnoxious. And the worst part about it is they got the greatest fucking talent of the world.
Yeah.
Everybody that's hired from them, they don't hire... All right, never mind. I shouldn't say that. I wasn't going to say they don't hire scrubs. But we know how that goes. But the majority of the talent they have is just... The best talent goes there, okay? But I'm not going to fucking sit there and watch it because somebody just not know how to fucking write a script or some 75-year-old fucking lunatic wants to change it 10 minutes before they start fucking taping or before they fucking go live and just change something that has potential to be the greatest fucking thing on earth be bullshit. I don't watch it. Stop fucking asking. I get this shit at least 2-3 times a week.
Being a YouTuber, I completely understand. I have people ask me all the time, what did you think of Raw? What did you think of SmackDown? I tell them, I haven't watched Raw and SmackDown consistently since 2010.
There is no reason for me to watch it. I'm sorry to cut you off, Bruce, but like we said back in August or fucking July, we're not going to say anything positive about the product. We're not going to fucking bring it here to the show.
Go ahead. And like, I had someone ask me the other day, a very respected subscriber, I will say that. He asked me why I haven't been reviewing the pay-per-views, and I told him straight up, because I have nothing good to say. And I'm tired of people, I don't care what people think about me,
right.
But it's gotten to the point now where I'm tired of people saying I'm just negative, when I'm just being honest about the product.
Right.
Because
you can't win. The IWC does that. You know what I mean? The internet. People do that. It's like you're just giving your fucking opinion. But then they're going to call you. If you say, you know, if you give WWE a negative review, they're going to say, oh, you're a mark for AEW. If you give AEW a fucking terrible review, like tonight, guarantee we're going to be called WWE marks. Guess what? I'm a fucking NWA mark. All right? No bones about it. But you get what I'm saying?
It's because you're saying something that they don't like. Let's just put it that
exactly. way. But they're going to call you a fucking mark if you don't like it. And if you don't like what they're like, or if they see you saying, if you fucking, WWE can put on one of the best shows. It's been fucking very long time since they put on a really fucking good show. The fact that SummerSlam was, what is that? I can't even read. Oh, that's a shit show. But it's a Vulcan literal horror show. It's not just a name.
Freak. Don't pull a Porter, okay?
Oh boy. Oh god damn it. Now we gotta add it again.
No, we don't. So anyways.
WWE sucks
right now. I mean, they could, don't get me wrong, for a while, the only thing I was watching was NXT and 205 Live, okay?
Oh, God.
Because I couldn't, shut up. So, 205 Live, it might not have been the best, but it was better than fucking SmackDown overall.
Okay. Yeah.
It might not have had any developing storylines, but there was a chance you can get 2 to 3 pretty decent fucking cruiserweight style matches. I don't even know. Is that still even a thing, 205 Live? I don't know.
Well, it's not live, I can tell you that. But I went to SmackDown 1000. That's the last WWE show I went to, just because I wanted to see Evolution live and Edge and stuff, and The Undertaker. But they taped 205 before the show, so they were no longer live. I cannot confirm if 205 actually exists anymore. At this point, though...
It's been ever since the pandemic, because they started doing, like, reruns. Well, but they would take, like, a particular 205 superstar and be like, oh, I'm showing you my most important match that influenced me in the past. And then they show, like, Hogan and Andre on 205 Live or some bullshit.
The Cruiserweight title is on NXT right now, correct?
They changed it.
So why
the Cruiserweight title to the NXT to Cruiserweight title without just like one day just showing up? Who I think it was a Tony that was the champion at the time, or was it Leo Rush? I don't remember.
Fucking one of those assholes. But why? Why have 205 Live when you don't have a title for that show? So.
That's a very valid point.
So I don't know if 205 Live, it's like Main Event and Superstars, do those still exist? I think Main Event does. Superstars, Main Event I couldn't does,
but I think it's a Hulu exclusive, so I don't even
Hulu?
Watch
it. Fuck Hulu.
I used to have it, and it's funny, because my wife was like, do we still have Hulu? I'm like, I don't fucking know. I never used the shit after we signed up for it, so I don't
yeah.
know. Like, I didn't even know. So, anyways, gentlemen. I'm about ready to wrap it up. You guys got anything intelligent that you want to add to the evening?
I think I'm good.
I'm going to take that as a no. Okay. especially with the look on Dan's face.
Right? This night was very, very
I'm sorry,
disappointing.
I'm busting your balls. It was a very disappointing show.
Yeah, so I was looking forward to this.
Yeah, I'm hoping that Wednesday will be a better show. Or is it Tuesday or Wednesday this week? I don't know. They've been changing it up the last couple of weeks because of... whatever, the playoffs or some bullshit.
Let's just put it this way, Rick. My silence is all because I had nothing good to say about the show. Let's just put it that way.
So, my question is this. We had another recent terrible pay-per-view by another company. It was considered a horror show. Which was the worst show? Or which was the better show? Which was... Do you think that was the worst show? Do you think this was better than the horror show?
Well, let's put it this way. I mean, better than fucking eyeballs. Let's put it that way. And swamp fucking matches. I mean, everything about this pay-per-view wasn't bad, but I mean, there could have been some points in this match where it could have been better. Like the whole syringe thing in the beginning. Like, okay, that was just demographic. Like, how the fuck did you get away with that bullshit?
Yeah.
And the thing with Extreme Rules was just like, you know,
going off of
ideas that AEW already built off of.
Yeah.
Eye for an eye, like obviously you're already copying off of somebody.
Okay, there is a key difference between these two shows.
Yeah,
Extreme Rules was made to fail. This one wasn't.
I was just being a dick when I asked for the comparisons, but you know, I think that you're right. It was made to fail. They were just like, we're in a shitty fucking time. I don't know how to fucking book this show. Let's just do it.
Like, and they booked it. They booked it to fail, whereas this pay-per-view had a good card. So what the fuck happened?
Crowd.
What happened?
Between the crowd, match is going a little too long. Stuff like that. Storytelling. I just think that for it was too early to do a live show. And the fact is that they were charging $50 for this fucking pay per view.
Was it 50? You
know, it was $50.
Yes. I thought it was 30. Oh my god!
No, it might have been 40 on Fight, but I think it was. Do they do TV? Do they do cable pay per views still? I know they were. AEW was, but I think that I don't know if they went exclusively to Fight or not. But
I don't know.
I don't know, but it was like 30. It was 50 from what I heard, and I was just like, "That's too much pay for a pay per view." I have not like, and it's like this pay per view was not worth. I mean, I would have paid 20, maybe $30 for this. It really even like I probably still would have been left scratching my head.
I'd rather pay the $20 to see fucking Tommy Rich drink some Coors Light and eat a Philly cheesesteak.
Oh, man. Don't say cheesesteak, man. I'm so hungry. I could go for a cheesesteak.
That's where I'm calling the show. Gentlemen, give out your social media so that people could try to find you if they care, like your ugly faces.
Go ahead, Dan.
You can find me on Facebook. You already know the name, so don't forget it. You can find me on Instagram at D_BNC187. And of course, you can find me on YouTube and Twitter at DanTheBeast94. So make sure you hit that subscribe button, especially if you're watching my channel and you're not subscribed. What the fuck are you doing?
Uh-oh.
Hit
that button. We had a vulgarity this time.
Well, Dan's getting aggressive.
He's getting sick of your shit.
This is what bad pay-per-views do to people.
DVD Freak on YouTube, Instagram, the period DVD Freak, because somebody stole my name, and I won't say who it was because last time it got edited out. So
that wasn't your fault because I just screamed out a random fucking name I shouldn't have. So
yeah, and then Twitter, the DVD Freak. I'm not big on social media, so yeah, YouTube. Just watch my shit. That's all I ask.
Go to the Rick Del Santo on Instagram and Twitter, and please subscribe to the Pro Wrestling Zone podcast on that streaming channel thing. YouTube, that's it. And you'll find lots of content. It's been a slow week, but we're going to be uploading much, much more. Yeah, micro content. I think this week this week is going to be a fucking amazing week. Tomorrow we are covering, it's September, we're covering Clash of the Champions, and we've got a number of them picked out. We're going chronological order. You two scrubs probably haven't watched yours yet, neither have I, but I'm gonna be home all day tomorrow. So Clash of the Champions 5, gentlemen. No JJ tomorrow, he's off again as well. He's quite the schedule because of the holiday and all that business. So thank you, everybody, for tuning in. We got a huge week coming up, so make sure you hit that subscribe button, share it to all your friends and enemies and all that shit. People you hate, we love you. Bye-bye, everybody. Why is it not-